Coming up on Almost Adults.
Yeah, all the way up until I was about 15, I was like a really kind of meddling kid in school. Like, it was the worst thing you can ever think of, especially when I was going through this weird fucking social anxiety. I saw a cartoony thing that's called Skyrim, and I clicked on it, and it was Harry's video. And on that video, I loved it so much. And I found out about like Newgrounds, which I knew about for years, but I found out like about the community of Newgrounds. And I joined that and I started making friends there and I started...
Oh, my friend Gage is gonna talk to you. Oh, and Jumper, oh, Jumper, he'll be there, oh, too. Even though they're not close together, they're far away there. One's in Tampa, the other one's in L.A. Oh, Gage, what's the show called again?
Fucking, it's Almost Adults. Shit.
Welcome to Almost Adults.
See, I wanted this to be like a slightly more professional podcast, but...
Okay, sorry.
I guess out the window right now.
Let me straighten my tie. Hello, welcome to Almost Adults, episode something. We've lost count at this point.
This is 25, if I'm counting right.
All right, welcome to episode 25 of Almost Adults. We have, as always, the lovely Gage Agnew.
Da-da-da-da!
And with us returning guest... After our Christmas special where he just did a bang-up job, we have the lovely Niall.
I never left. They kidnapped me. They captured me. I'm tied up.
Shut up now.
Okay.
All right, cool. So now, how are you doing this fine evening on the day after Christmas?
Oh, yes. It's December 26th, right?
December 26th, 2026.
Oh, well, I just woke up at like... 3:30, so like it's 4 o'clock now, so I'm still like waking up. I'd like my sleep schedule is kind of fucked, but enough about that shit. I'm okay, how are you?
Actually, now that you mentioned sleep schedules, my sleep schedule has been out of whack. I got this Fitbit charge for Christmas, and it like tracks my sleep.
It's creepy.
Yeah, it is. Like, some nights I get like 3 hours of sleep, and other nights I get like 11. It's way inconsistent.
Have you guys ever watched that show Black Mirror?
Yes.
A little bit, yeah.
Fuck, that show has made me get more paranoid about technology. And like, I thought like, you know, the Amazon Alexa, I thought that was the coolest thing ever. And now watching that, I'm like almost kind of terrified of it.
What episode did you watch?
I watched them all up until season 3. I haven't started season 3 yet. And I heard that's the best one, so.
I saw the first 2 episodes of season 3 and I thought they're all right.
Ew.
Not to be that guy that's like,
I saw the first 3 episodes of Westworld and I only thought that was all right. And everyone's fucking... calming over that show.
Yeah.
Too many plot holes.
I walked in on my mom watching Westworld, and I assumed it was the first episode because there was some dude who shot another cowboy guy and was dragging away a woman who was screaming
for her life. Every single episode.
Okay. I assumed it was really rapey vibes. I guess it was off-putting.
It is a good show, but it's just there's so many plot holes. Like, unless they fill them all, I've only watched 3 episodes, but
see,
like...
See, they do that, but it's one of those shows they're like, oh, you have to just plow through the however many episodes. And I don't think a show should do that.
Yeah,
I think
no,
a show
me
should
neither.
Just be good from the beginning. God.
Yeah, it's like BoJack Horseman syndrome when a fucking show, it's like, oh, it gets good on episode 11.
It's exactly BoJack. Yeah, I don't want to plow through 10 episodes. Thank you. No one understands this philosophy but me, apparently. And Niall.
Or Final Fantasy syndrome, like the new ones where it's like, oh, it gets really good 100 hours in.
Yeah. Whenever I saw someone streaming the 15th one, it was so boring.
I've been playing the 15th one and I really like it.
Oh.
Well, I wasn't actually talking about that one because I heard that one was actually good, but I mean, like, what's the one, 13 I think it was for the PS3?
Is the one with lightning and like 13-2 whatever?
Yeah, I just heard that like that one gets good 100 hours in.
I've heard the same thing, but I played it and it's whatever's featured in that JonTron episode where they're just walking down the hallway and you just hear the clip-clop of her feet. That was as far as I could get, which is the beginning of the game. It was just mind-numbing. But I like the 15th one. It's just a bunch of guys riding around the
car. It looks pretty good and like the guys do seem like they're real and stuff, but at the same time, it's kind of gay. You have to say that when you're playing Final Fantasy, though. You have to try to put the gayness aside. Like, it's, like, really good, but it's kind of gay. I think that describes most of them, except for 7. 7 was just great. It was, like, badass. It was cool. It was manly.
Have you played 9?
I love 9. I have to admit, I have a huge soft spot for 9.
See, our friend Kat gave me 9 for Christmas, and we're going to play it on stream together. And it's my first Final Fantasy, so I have no idea what to expect.
It's sweet, dude. That's a good one. It's a good one to start with. Play all 7, right. Too. 8 sucks.
So I've heard.
Is 8 the one with Squall?
Yeah.
Okay.
He's just this faggot emo who's like, do you swallow your pride? Wow. And he like, it's just weird.
I'll give you something to swallow.
6, everyone says the story of 6 is like the best. Which, it is a really good story. It has mechs and shit, if I'm not mistaken. If that's the one, the right one I've played. It kind of looks like an RPG Maker game, but it's cool.
All right. Welcome to Weebcast, everybody.
Oh, yeah. We did start kind of delving into Weeb territory.
Final cast.
Yeah, I know. Like, 5 minutes ago, I was like, this is going to be our first serious podcast ever. Then we're like, oh, dude, did you play Final Fantasy?
Well, we just had to get the icebreaker out of the way. We got to bring our listeners back into the mindset.
We got to kind of ease them into it. Okay, Jean-Claude, do you want to start with the first question for our distinguished guest?
Okay. It's almost like a who wants to be a millionaire kind of deal. I know. It's like, all right, Niall.
Yeah.
First question of the evening. So tell us a little bit about yourself, Niall. Give us our listeners a little bit of background about, you know, where'd you grow up? What were you like?
No one cares about that shit. It's boring. Boo. No, I'm just kidding. When I was a kid, when I was 4, I moved to Ireland from America. I lived in America for 4 years, which I think explains my half-American accent somehow. As a kid in school, I was kind of a troublesome kid. I was like that kid who like would throw things at the teacher and just like make noises in class. That annoying like fucking asshole kid who thought he was funny in school. But I was like a short and fat kid, so like I thought I had to be funny in order to survive. Mm-hmm, it's classified survival guide school.
Yeah, still a good show.
And as a kid, I was a bold little brat who liked to play with his toys. No, I wasn't a brat. The one bratty thing I did do, though, that I remember is I really wanted Spyro 2 when it came out, and I had a tantrum in the store. I was like the kid who was like, give it to me! My mom was like, get the fuck out, and she like almost beat the shit out of me for that. But I deserved it that time. Yeah, all the way up until I was about 15, I was like a really kind of meddling kid in school. And then when I was 16, I went into this class where we got to go on a class trip. So it was good the entire year. And all my cool friends ditched me because I was like quiet now because I wanted to go on this school trip to Barcelona at the end of the year.
Oh, and then son of a bitch.
All the nerds tucked me in. Yeah. So it was so weird. I just became like this weird, like really socially anxiety person. Like this happened after like, I don't know how it just, it was like a click of a switch. It was our puberty or something. I like went from just being like saying whatever the hell I wanted just came into my head and just being like a little brat. And then
like very reserved about stuff,
to
right?
To being really, really reserved and just being like, hey, thanks, but.
I actually had a similar transition with that. Like
I was like, oh, sorry, go on.
No, I was just saying like in middle school, I was like loudmouth and then like a kid showed me up and then I was quiet for the rest of middle school.
Yeah, I think like girls wise, like I was able to get girls just by being like, I didn't get a lot, like I was just a kid, but like girls liked me just for, because I was short and fat, I remember. So like they liked me for just me being like kind of funny and just like a little bit rebellious. Back in the rebellious stages. Then I became like skinny and better looking, but like really awkward and no one liked me. It was just fucking weird. It was just, and then I wasn't allowed to go on the trip anyway.
What?
May I add. Yeah.
Why? What was the reasoning?
The school principal fucking hated me for like the
years prior, yeah.
Yeah, most of the teachers did not like me. Because I was a bit of a messer, but I was never, like, violent. Like, I wasn't, like, that kind of... I was just, like, a little bit of a messer. But, yeah, the principal fucking hated me. One day he kicked me out of school and completely denied it. Because it's illegal for the principal to kick an underage kid out of school. And I was seriously thinking of getting hit by a car on purpose or, like, breaking my legs or something. Just because, like, I wanted him to get fucking fired. He actually did get fired. I don't know why since then, but...
Probably kicking you out.
Hope so.
Kicking someone else out.
Fucking bitch.
Jesus.
Yeah, so then... I became a kind of a good boy, and that's how I ended up getting into like middle school because I was like actually studious and good. I don't know why that happened. And then as soon as I got into college, I became back to my normal like retarded fucking stupid self who just says whatever. I don't know why my brain did this to me.
Did you go to college in Ireland?
Yeah.
I assume it's the same kind of thing. Once you get to college, just no one gives a fuck.
Oh yeah, in that sense it is. But it's like college in Ireland is completely different. Like I feel like it makes more sense in Ireland maybe because like you can go straight from high school to do whatever course you want. Instead of doing 4 years of like just general college and fucking draining your money.
Life savings, yeah.
Yeah, it's like a lot cheaper and you can just do whatever the hell you want. So it's kind of cool.
I do admire that system, but I like the concept of college in that when you get there, everyone's too busy doing their own things to kind of make fun of you and whatever weird awkwardness you have. So
yeah.
Everyone stops giving a fuck and
that's what happens. Yeah.
You come out of your shell. It's great.
You do. Yeah. And it is good. Except like for me, none of my friends did the same course I did. So like I was the only one. And then like I did this extra year in school called transition year, which they do in Ireland. It's kind of a year of doing nothing after like a big exam after you're 15 or something. So you go into this year called transition year, and that's the year actually where they go on the trip. And a lot of people in Ireland don't do that year. So like everyone in my course was like a year younger than me, and like they all knew each other and no one knew me. And then like they all became friends. And then the people that were from other parts of the country all kind of lived near each other in the like college campus. I still lived at home, so they all became friends. So it was like the opposite for me. In college, I didn't really have like many friends. I had a few, but no real close friends. So like I never really went. That probably did not help with the friends thing.
That's brutal.
It's kind of my fault.
So you kind of explained how you're kind of prompting from like transition to like, oh, this is when I was shy. Oh, this is when I was unattractive. Can you point to any event that prompted these transitions, or maybe at least in a couple instances?
Yeah, well, I feel like, honestly, I was like 5 foot and I'd say about 180 pounds when I was like, I looked like Andy Milonakis until I was like 15. I wasn't that bad, but I accepted that I was going to be like that. I was like, okay, I'm a short guy. I need to be funny or whatever. So I tried to do that. I wasn't even that funny. I was just like trying too hard, probably pissing everybody off. And then when I was 16, I had a growth spurt. And also, I wasn't really able to like be funny anymore because my brain fucking changed and I just was so awkward. Then I was like, all right, I'm gonna have to lose the weight. And I started growing at the same time. I was like, sweet. I already accepted of being a short and fat dude, and then I became taller and skinny. So that's what prompted that, like the weight loss. Also, I wanted to get healthy and I didn't want to have man titties anymore. I used to like seldomly got made fun of for being fat, like, but I did. Like, this is like a really sad story, but there are these like disco kind of things for like underage people called the socials over there. And then like one day I was like wearing my new shirt and I was like so happy to go out to this thing, and I was like, yeah, tonight I'm going to get a girl. Because in Ireland, well, that was like one of my priorities, was just to get like, I don't know, I was like a little faggot back then. But I was like all dressed up and I was waiting for the bus, because they had this bus like that brought you out there.
Mm-hmm.
And then some dude who was like right ahead of me in the queue to get into the bus turned around, put his first two fingers like under my man tit and like moved them up. And like for the rest of the night, I was just crushed.
Oh, he scooped you. Aww. He scooped you, man.
He scooped me. Is that a real thing?
Yeah. So I went to for high school, an all-guys school, which I'm sure screwed me up in some way.
There was a lot of scooping.
There was this kid, Colin Madden, who would come up to any guy with a little bit of man.
Oh, you're just
going
to name and shame this motherfucker.
Sorry. I mean, he's a perfectly natural guy now. Everyone was a douche in high school. But he would come up to guys and just scoop that voice and put his two fingers under your man titty and flick them up.
Yeah. We had a guy who fingered asses. Though I said that on the Sleepy Cat podcast. It was like a rogue finger guy.
Jesus.
He was an asshole.
If you want to go see that, go listen to Sleepycabin, a much better podcast than ours.
It's true. I'm just kidding. It's not really that great.
I had a weird transition moment. When you brought up the man boobs thing, it reminded me, I was in middle school, and there was kind of the parents always got together and did this weird rib-off barbecue festival thing once a year. It would be at this one guy's house, and he had a big pool in his backyard where they would all bring their smoking things and do barbecue. So all the kids would go swim in the pool. I've always been just a skinny, lanky kid, but for some reason, when puberty was hitting, I was still skinny as fuck, but I had really prominent nipples.
Prominent nipples?
Yeah, pokey nipples. I don't know what the hormones were doing there.
Wait. How prominent? Like, what were they, like, big? Or, like,
pointy? They weren't big. Like, the areolas weren't big. It was just, like, they were pokey.
They were really, like, you always had erect nipples?
Yeah, like, horny, erect nipples. I don't know
were
what was going
sensitive?
On.
Were they sensitive?
Maybe.
Horny, erect nipples.
I don't know. I don't remember whether or not they were sensitive.
So, you're saying is your nipples are growing faster than your body was.
Because I was wondering if you had this thing called gyno. It's like this thing where like dudes grow tits, but like really small tits, most of them.
Gynecomastia is what you're talking about. And I thought that I did for a while, but it was just the nipples. I never actually grew man boobs. I never figured out what it was, but it went away.
I thought I had gynecomastia as well, but then I realized I was just fat.
Well, like you and I, they both resolved themselves. But for some reason, I took off my shirt and this one kid that was there was just like, dude, what's wrong with your nipples? And like made a point to like point out how pointy my nipples were. And then I have a feeling from then on, I'd always been sort of reserved. But after that point, I just kind of got even more awkward.
I don't know how it is here, but in Ireland, like people will find anything to make fun of you about. Like, I had too many shots one night out at some dude's 18th birthday party. When I came back to school the next day, or like a few days later, everyone was going, bleh. Anytime I'd walk by anyone, they'd just go, bleh. I was like, dude, come on. Everybody pukes when they drink, mm-hmm. when they're underage and they drink too much. It's like, sometimes you just get unlucky. Does that happen over here?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. People will still.
Yeah, all the time.
I've had like several like severe bulk. I actually forgot to say that one year where I just became an awkward dude, I got like severely bullied by like people who used to be my friends. Like,
oh no, that shit happened all the time to me.
This is a true story. This actually made my life like hell for that year. And if any of them are listening, they probably fucking laugh at this because it was kind of funny. It's kind of funny now, but back then it was not funny. We used to go drinking underage. Okay, wait, I'll go back even further. So when you're 12 in Ireland, you have this thing called the confirmation, which is like this religious thing, which is like you're confirming that you're believing in God and shit. Then you take this pledge. And back then I was 12. I didn't know what I was doing. I was like, you take it. Most people take it until they're 18 because it's you're legally allowed to drink until you're 18. But some people take it till they're 16, but they're known as the rebels. But I was like, I'm such a good boy. I'm going to take it till 21. And then my parents were like, you are great, Niall. I broke it when I was like 14. But anyway, like 2 years later.
Is your dad Jesus by chance?
Yes. Yes, he's Whoa. Jesus Christ himself. Yeah, so we used to go kind of drinking in this place called Old Folks. I don't know, because I think it was near an old folks home or old people started walking there. I don't know. Yeah, the cops were always caught on. I don't know. It was a terrible place. It was kind of in the open. It was surrounded by bushes, so it wasn't, but like the cops always knew we were there. Where was I going with this? Oh, yeah. Okay, so I was 16. I was trying to, you know, get out and be more social, just to be like, get out of this frame of mind. I was like, what's wrong with me? So I finally went out, because this is when people started kind of going out drinking. And I was like, you know what? My old best friend, this is one of my best friends for years before that, who kind of shunned me with the rest of everybody else when that started happening, but I was trying to come back out of my shell, so I was like, yo, can you come with me to get vodka? And he was like, yeah, sure. So we walked, and I bought this big old thing of vodka, and it was what we call a naggin. It wasn't that much, but back then when I was 16 and inexperienced, what it was enough to get me really drunk. So I brought that back, started drinking it, finished it, and was starting to get very, very drunk. And I was like, okay. Then these guys who used to be my friends started handing me these cans of Bulmers, which is this cider. It's like the kind of biggest cider in Ireland. People from England know it as Magners. It's the same thing. So I was drinking that and I was getting drunker and drunker. Then at the end of the night, everyone goes, ah! Everyone started pointing and laughing at me saying, there was Cydona in that can. And Cydona is this like cider with no alcohol. So everyone was laughing at me and they're all like, you're pretending to be drunk. But no one fucking took into account the vodka that I had drank earlier. And I got bullied for this for a whole fucking year. Like an entire year. And then we were on the school bus and I was like, I was trying to get out of it. And I was like, friend who went with me to get the vodka, didn't you come with me to get vodka? You saw me drinking the vodka? And he just turns his head around, looks at me and goes, no. And everyone was like, and they all pointed and laughed at me. And
this to, like, is like a Shakespeare tragedy right here.
It was
here.
So bad. And then like, this went on for so long. And then like, anytime I'd go on the bus or anything, they'd start singing like the song that was on the commercials of Bulmers, like the cider. It was like, it's the time of the season. Everyone would start like clapping and going, ah! And like it was just all eyes pointing and laughing at me. Like, it was the worst thing you can ever think of, especially when I was going through this weird fucking social anxiety. That went on for like, again, that year. But the guy, the ringleader behind that, was like one of my like good friends. And like, cause I didn't even have that many friends anymore, so I still was like, he was one of my only dudes, so I was like still friends with him. And meanwhile, anytime we'd be in public, this motherfucker would like completely make a fool of me.
Sold you out.
Yeah.
Fuck.
He's gotten better. Okay, so after I became normal again after that year. I don't know what happened that year, but
what's your definition of normal?
Well, actually, no. It wasn't normal, but I was like.
Also, quick thing about that story. They need to find something like better to laugh about. That's very, very,
I know.
Like,
that was the worst part of that. Absolutely nothing that they were giving me relentless torture over. It was nothing. And I was like, seriously, like a joke.
I mean, if you peed your pants or like puked on a girl, I would understand it. But like, that's just like, who cares?
But in fairness, I should have laughed along with them, which I learned after a while. I started doing that, and when it started fading away a little bit. But then when it started fading away, it would just come straight back up again. Everyone go, and they wouldn't let me. They wouldn't let me laugh at it to get out of it. They wouldn't, like, honestly, I remember I started working in a bar with that guy. And I was like, dude, take a picture of me on your phone of me surrounded with these cans of Bulmers, just, you know, to make a joke out of it. So he took the picture, then decided, no, I'm not going to put this out there because this will stop him from being bullied, or like this will do something to dent the bullying. So I'm going to delete the fucking photo. And like,
maybe he was trying to be your friend and like, no, hey, no, I don't want to bring this up again.
Motherfucker. No. He'd still bring it up every time I'd go into school.
Oh, never mind.
Wait, I had somewhere to go before or some sort of point before I went back into that.
You said then I went normal again.
Oh, yeah. Well, I didn't go normal. I was like, I accepted the more reserved version of me. I was like, okay. I no longer can, on a whim, just say whatever I want. You know, for people with, like, social anxiety, they know, like, your brain kind of has, like, a barrier which, like, stops you from saying things. Because you kind of keep thinking, it's like, will they hate me if I say this? Or will they say
the
wrong
thing? Yeah, you think about the consequences.
Will I say the wrong thing? Will I do... Yeah, like, I just learned to, like, live with that. I had friends that were more, like, I had more kind of nerdy friends, which more reserved friends, which became, like, they're still my friends to this day. They're much better friends than the other dudes. So, yeah, and then I started to kind of live with that. And then once I got into college, I started kind of feeling normal again, and then I became like back to normal just a little bit. I'm a little bit less wild than I was back then. I still have a lot of elements of kind of both versions of me. So yeah, that got really personal. Really fucking personal.
No. I love that sort of shit on this podcast, but you keep saying normal. If we're going too far with the personal stuff,
no.
You can just
it's
be like,
it's fine.
Eh,
it's
I just
wonder if people think, be like, ugh. I don't give a shit.
No, I'm curious what your definition of normal was, because you keep saying, I got more normal, I got less normal.
Okay, that's a good question. I was defining normal as the norm, like the mainstream, like what most people wanted you to be like. That's kind of how I like lived my life for the first like year. I wanted to kind of impress everybody and just be cool. But then I realized when I got older, it's like to be in the mainstream normal group, you have to have the most normal traits. You have to be like boring and normal. Like that's it. They just accept people that are normal. And like they go out drinking at nighttime, they're kind of in their own little group. It's boring to me. It's actually boring. Like I'm much happier doing what I'm doing now.
Oh yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. Like, oh, you gotta go to church every Sunday, you gotta like go to this job with these certain amount of hours.
Well yeah, that's probably more of an American definition. In Ireland it's more like you just you drink all the time.
Okay.
Now I drink alone.
That's
so much happier. So you got normal and you did the med school thing, but you got out of that and then you joined somewhere down the road, Sleepycabin, right?
Yeah, well, it was a little bit more complicated than that. Was in med school. It wasn't med school per se. It was like biomedical science. It was like kind of a precursor to med school, but you could also go into like any sort of medical field or just stay in biomedical science. But they're all in the same kind of ballpark. They're all like medical and really high paying jobs. You work in like a hospital or like a laboratory or become an actual MD or whatever. Because with me, I'd go into class and then I'd understand everything for the first few lessons. Then I might like doze off or like miss a day or something, come back and have no idea. And then like I would sit down and study it. I have no desire to learn about this fucking pharmacology or anything. It bored me. It was just, I like biology, I like anatomy, I like all that stuff, but nah, I just dropped out. So
what caused you to doze off those first couple of days?
I have ADD. I can't really focus on things very well.
All right, I thought you were staying up late slaying the ladies.
No, not really. Well, I don't know. Like I
well, maybe.
I wasn't slaying like left, right, and center like I am now, you know? I wasn't like the fucking huge stud muffin like I am on this day. I'm just kidding, but oh, wait, I need a stretch. Fuck. So
he's flexing right now.
Yeah, baby. So I was like, okay, I think it was like 2011. I was in school. I think I told this story before. I don't know if I did. I was sitting in a lab for like some shitty subject that I didn't care about. I was watching the Skyrim trailer, and then I was like, oh, this game looks cool. I can't wait for this to come out. And then I saw like in a little sidebar thing, I saw a cartoony thing that's called Skyrim. I clicked on it, and it was Harry's video.
It was Harry Partridge. Oh,
and
yeah.
And that video, I loved it so much.
And like, it's him and Chris, right?
Yeah, I didn't know who they were back then, but I loved that video so much back then. I loved it way too much. Like, it was a really good video, but I just fucking loved it. I was like, I want to make stuff like this. I was like, this dude is just, like, on YouTube making video, like, cartoons. Because secretly in my brain, I always, like, thought it would be cool to be an animator, but I never thought it was feasible as a career. And I was like, these guys are, like, making money just, like, animating. That's, like, the dream. Mm-hmm. I was like, holy shit, I could just do this? And then I started doing it. And I was shit, so... But, like, I started kind of making little things. And then I started kind of finding out animators. Like, I started finding Chris. I found Zach. I found Ed's World. Mm-hmm. Harry was the OG for me.
And it still kind of is.
I found Ego Raptor. And I found all these dudes, and I started finding out that all their different senses of humor, and then all their same senses of humor, like all the similar things that they had. And I was like, oh, that's funny. They all have this little community. And then I found out about like Newgrounds, which I knew about for years, but I found out like about the community of Newgrounds. And I joined that, and I started making friends there. And I started, and as this kid who wanted to fit in with all these normal people, making friends online back then, and it was only 2011, only about 5-6 years ago, it was still a very weird thing to do for like a lot of people over there.
I still think it's a weird thing to do, and like I make most of my friends online nowadays.
Yeah, so, but me too. And I kind of kept it a secret that I started making all these animator buddies, and like, and they started becoming cool. And then I started in a Skype call with some of them, and then I made like friends there, and I met this like girl who I liked, and then we started dating, and then she was from America. I was already making contingency plans of like leaving college, bailing my house because my parents were going to kill me, and moving to America. And I was like, dude, I have friends that live around here in this place. You live around here, so like I'm just gonna do it. So I fucking did it, and I moved to like New Jersey, bordering Philly, kind of that area. Then I attended Pico Day, where I met Chris and Zach, and they were really, really cool and nice to me. I was like, whoa, those guys are fucking humble and sweet. Like, and I was like, cool. I don't know how I added them on Skype, and I started talking to them. Then we became friends, and then I got fired from my job when I lived with this girl, and I was like, dude, I will not be able to pay rent.
It the retail job?
Yeah.
Quick recap, Niall looked up a skirt of his manager.
No, this is a different retail job.
Oh, okay.
this is one in America. And then Chris goes, dude, you can just move in with me in Ireland. And I was like, dude, are you sure? And he was like, yeah. He's like, he was so cool. He just like let me live with him, even though I only met him once. Then we became buddies like when I moved in with him. And it was back in Ireland, and I kind of wanted to go back to Ireland anyway. I was feeling a little bit homesick. Yeah. So that was fun. And then when he moved to Philly, that August, he's like, why don't you just move to Philly with me? You're a citizen. I was like, cool. Then I moved in with like Chris, Zach, Stamper, Corey, Shad. Oh man, I hope I'm not missing anybody. But yeah, I moved in with those guys. That was really, really fun. When we moved, Chris moved not to do the podcast. He moved to do Hellbenders, but the podcast just started up, so it like worked out really well. And I used to kind of go and listen to the podcast, like them being recorded, and I fucking laughed so hard at them. Like I was like, man, this is gonna be huge. Like this is fucking hysterical. This is no brain like Corey. Like Corey was just like my favorite. Like anything he said like made me howl. And then like one day I was like drawing on my tablet in the Sleepycabin office because they let me go there and use it. They were cool like that. And I was just drawing on my tablet and standing. Stamper, Zach, and I don't know who else. They started recording. Stamper goes, hey, Niall, do you want to just join? And I was like, I don't know. I don't know if I say anything. Then I started recording with them, and people actually, like, there were a lot of Who's Niles and stuff, but, like, they seemed to like me, so I just came back. And I don't even know when I became a formal member. It just happened. And, yeah.
By the way, excellent Stamper impression.
Yeah, sometimes I can do it pretty well. Like, I can do the kind of down Stamper, the one that's kind of like, you know, just doing his own business. He's minding his own business, drinking and fucking beer. That one, but yeah, I can't really do the more upbeat one.
God, you can only do Stamper and Zach. God, what kind of voice actor are you?
Wait, he's able to do Zach?
Yeah.
Oh, but yeah. I have a really bad flu right now.
That's a very specific voice. Is his normal voice like that?
I know you asked me that last time. Yeah, his normal voice is like that. He's not putting on a voice. That's his actual voice.
That's awesome. All right,
we're going to cut this part out, but Jean-Claude, I think the secret is he just has Zach record, and then they say it's Niall talking.
It's not true.
Okay, possible. Never mind. Theory debunked. We're not cutting that out. Theory debunked.
So it's wild, the entire story regarding how you kind of became a part of Sleepycabin and met that whole entire crew, because, I don't know, just being an animator, part animator, whatever you would consider me, who's also watched Harry Partridge videos, you know, seen Zach's stuff, Chris's stuff, Ego Raptor, all those people, everyone's animation work and kind of idolized that. I mean, you, Sleepycabin, those members.
They were the top. They were the dudes who were like the best.
Yeah, they are the best animators.
And the most successful. And the funniest. They were successful for a reason, because like they were genuinely like the funniest dudes. And I still think like that era of animators are kind of the funniest dudes to ever go on YouTube. Like I don't think there's anything like funnier than that stuff.
Absolutely. You were right in saying that it was kind of, they had their own little circle, and when you watch Sleepycabin, you listen to Sleepycast, they all know each other, the animated community, and it's all because of Newgrounds and Pico Day and things like that.
Yeah.
But it seems like it's like this impenetrable wall to get involved with that. I mean, we're fortunate enough that we got to talk with you and that we got to talk with Mick and stuff like that.
Oh,
it's wild.
It does. It just It seems like it kind of happens. What I kind of have learned in my time in both college and Los Angeles, where I am right now, is like most of the time when you approach people asking for help or advice, or just not asking them to do your fucking work for you, they will more likely than not help you out.
Oh yeah, just be a genuinely kind human being.
Yeah, that's how I met Pilar. I asked her about writing and she's like, yeah, come on over. And yeah, I still like her to this day.
Is this a little crush you got?
Nah, she's like 40 years old with 2 kids.
So it's a crush you have? Yeah, okay.
So it's a crush, yeah.
The best way to get your crush is to ask them on air to marry you.
That's good. Yeah, you put the pressure on them right there.
They can't say no.
Yeah. Because of the implications.
This is a super weeby story, and it's going to cut our audience into some sort of fraction I can't even measure, but I tend to go to a lot of conventions, and I went to one recently.
You bozo.
I went to one recently for Christmas, and we were walking around the floor, and we were by the bar, we were getting drinks, and we were just waiting around, and some guy just starts announcing to the whole entire hotel, and the hotel that the convention was in was just kind of normal people enjoying their vacation in Florida, and then the rest of the people cosplaying in whatever Naruto, whatever the hell they're dressing as. So it's weird like that. So this guy just starts announcing to the whole entire hotel that Naruto, some guy dressed up as Naruto, and this girl Hinata, he asked her to marry him, and she said yes, and he's announcing this to the whole entire hotel, and then you look over at her, standing next to this Naruto guy, and she is miserable.
Oh, no.
And in that case, like, you have to say yes, because, like...
I know.
That is the implication right there.
I knew exactly what had just gone down, and I just felt... I was like, they're going to have a talk in that hotel room later on this evening.
Oh, for sure.
That
makes
bad.
Me just uncomfortable. I wasn't even near there, just hearing that story just...
It was bad. So we got drinks and we walked away.
Anyways, back to just talking with people. Yeah, I feel like we've done that actually a lot through this podcast, just kind of talking to people and sort of building those relationships. That really just comes down to asking the person. That's all I wanted to say. Yeah.
Yeah, and the worst they can say is fuck you.
Absolutely.
Worst they can say is fuck you, and you're like, well, fuck you right back, and you go on with your life.
Pretty much. Mm-hmm.
That's adulthood.
That actually is it. Just people just say fuck you. That's the worst that can happen. And if they say that, then they're an asshole. You don't.
That's literally the worst that can happen, and there's a 0.0001 chance that will happen.
Yeah. And if it does, they're the asshole. You can just be like, well.
Yeah, you didn't do anything wrong. Yeah. You just asked. Most of the time when people say no, they're super polite about it. And they're like, sorry, I got to do this, this, and this. And most of the time you can understand. Just don't be a flippin' weirdo like me.
Exactly. Yeah, so Niall, so you joined Sleepycabin, you became an animator, you started doing artwork a lot more. What's your current position right now? Are you actually making like good income off of commissions, or is that your kind of full-time work?
Not really. I do like little alternative things on the side, like a bit of web stuff. But like, yeah, I still have commissions backed up for like fucking months. I really need to get on that. And but yeah, no, it's an okay way of making money. I mean, I only do it when I'm like really desperate. Like I only do it when I like fucking need money. Like I was moving to California there in June, so I was like, dude, please commission me, man. I gotta eat, man. I gotta need somewhere to live. So I did that. I made enough to get here, and I do it every now and then. It's pretty fun. I like doing it. It's a nice kind of way to make side income, but it's not really a way to make a living, I don't think. Not the way I'm doing it anyway. I'm sure if I was smarter, I could like figure out how to turn that into an actual career, but yeah.
I think it just kind of boils down to organization.
Yeah, which I'm the least organized person ever, like on the fucking planet.
I found this artist the other day. I want to say she's the most successful person on Patreon. She goes by the name like Sakimi-chan.
Oh, yeah. Oh, really? I've never heard of her. She does porn probably, yeah?
She does do porn. Yeah.
Yeah, that's why. If it's a girl that does porn, you're going to make bank.
She draws a lot of anime characters and it's really good stuff. Like it's really high quality work. I mean, I think it's only Patreon subscribers get to see the porn aspect, but I looked up her Patreon, so she does
I've seen this girl's work before.
A bi-monthly payment plan, so she releases like tutorials.
She makes $60,000 a month because
she
like,
makes double,
two terms
oh, yeah,
per month.
$60,000 a month. And so over if she like does her best thing over the course of a year, she can make over $500,000 doing what she does.
Wow.
Yeah. But she's skilled. She's very skilled.
Oh, she's very, very good. And
dude, I keep thinking of like just making a new persona in porn and just like doing it because it pays fucking well. Like, I remember some people who listen to this would know Shadman. He was a guest on the podcast. He runs like a porn website, like a hentai website. We were at Magfest 1 year. This fucking Lamborghini parked outside Magfest, and like the license plate said hentai on it. Shad was just like, senile porn pays. And like, yeah, I never forgot that. Like, and Shad, he's doing well for himself. And like,
is that Shad's vehicle, or was it just a random vehicle on the street?
It was just a random. No, no, no.
Well, then how the fuck would he know?
It was just funny. It's just because like whoever did it probably is a successful hentai artist, or just really fucking loves it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was like, I need to make a persona where I'm a girl and I like draw porn and just like.
Well, actually, speaking of personas, you sort of have like a character of yourself on Sleepycabin, sort of like the. Gosh, now I'm afraid to describe the character because I don't want to insult you.
Oh, you can go ahead.
Just being like a kind of sad, sort of downbeat guy who has like a good heart. Sort of like a...
Good guy, Niall?
Yeah, I like that meme. You know that meme, Niall? You remember the memes? You seen the... Okay, you know what I mean, right?
No. Oh. It's, oh. But no, I don't know. I haven't seen the memes. I mean, I was joking about that.
Oh,
good. No, I guess it's not like really me as much. It's kind of is like, I don't try to really exaggerate it, but it's just naturally once that microphone turns on, it's like fucking everyone just goes crazy. It's like, it's kind of funny. It's like push of a button. Everyone starts going, ah, ah. We would never just sit down on the couch and go, ah, like scream over each other. Like, it's just, I feel like when I did it first, that was when I had that like breakup and, I talked about it on the podcast and I was really downbeat mm-hmm. back then and like I was fucking upset and people liked that. I guess I kind of kept it up a little bit. I don't actually talk like, look guys, I think that's all like just for the podcast. I do all that shit for the podcast. It's not scripted. Like I do say what I feel like on it, or I did.
I thought you wrote the entire podcast.
So it's like, it is like obviously part of me, but it's I feel like the persona. I'm not saying I'm smart, but I definitely come across as an absolute idiot on that podcast, and I know I'm not an idiot. That is one thing that like I kind of regret, is like coming across as this ignorant fucking ignoramus dumbass on that podcast.
Well, yeah, that's sort of the stuff we were kind of talking about. I think Jeff and Zach are also the really prominent examples, because Zach with his sort of Hitler thing and Johnny Utah with sort of his cynicism.
I don't know how to speak.
Well, fuck you, I'm done.
Hopefully those improv classes are going well for you.
Yeah, God.
First one's this Thursday, ladies and gentlemen. Look at your local listings. I'm sorry, what was I saying? Something about, like, being characters Jeff. Apart to, like, real
no,
life.
Jeff actually is like that. Jeff, like, he genuinely is like that, except he does. Which I think it does come across on the podcast, and he would hate me saying this, but Jeff has the biggest heart of gold out of anybody I've ever met. Aww. He seriously is. Aww. It's true. Like, when I fucking randomly passed out and was in the hospital, he was, like, the only dude who came to check up on me.
Really?
He was like,
really?
Yeah, he was.
When did you pass out and go to the hospital?
I don't know. 1 year, I was, like, I ate too many vitamins, and, like, I went to the cinema, and I passed out, and I woke up in an ambulance.
Oh, I think you told this story.
Okay, I was just gonna say, did I just have a deja vu? I could have sworn I heard this story before.
Yeah, yeah. So, like, back then, it was, like, Jeff. And then, like, he's always good. He was always just good and kind. Deep down. It's true. He'll hate it being out there. But Jeff, I'm exposing your heart of gold.
Those are the best kind
God,
of people.
God, how dare you?
So what are your goals for the current future? That didn't make any sense.
The current future. Like,
the current future. Not the future in the past. Not the future ahead.
That was two
future.
Sentences that fused together. It's like, what are your goals currently, or what are your goals for the future? What are your goals for the current future?
I'm trying to get to LA to live. That's kind of my goal, so I'm kind of trying to do what it takes. Like,
hentai, yeah, man.
Sucking dicks on the side.
Draw Naruto.
If you don't mind me asking, what web work were you doing on the side? Just like programming or something?
Oh, yeah. I'm just a cam girl.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
that's
that
good money.
Sense.
And it's all about not showing too much too soon. It's all about subtlety.
Yeah, you need to kind of find the right momentum, because like there's going to be people going in to your stream at all times. You don't want them coming in when you're in the middle of having a fucking butt plug in your ass. You want them to come in and ask you for the butt plug.
Exactly.
Your ass.
Yeah.
Can you hide the butt plug and then they can ask you for like another one and you just shove a second one in there?
Well, you just don't understand.
Probably not.
You don't understand the intricacies of butt plugs,
Gage. I don't know what the appeal of that would be.
Yeah, I mean, no one's going to see the butt plug if you're sitting down, and if they ask you to put another one in, you could just put one in, and it seems like you have one butt plug, but in reality, you have one butt plug poking out and one just completely inside.
Yeah, that's it. That's the you discovered it.
I nailed it.
You cracked it. You're now
cracked the code.
It's done.
You're the one making $60,000 a month now.
Yeah.
Double butt plug, Gage.
God, my parents are going to kill me for that one. I'm going to be like, this is the first special serious interview that we've ever done on the podcast. Please check it out.
Do they listen?
Nah, my mom listens more than my
Gage
dad.
Is a rapist. He's a child rapist. Your son, he rapes children every day.
He learned it from her, okay?
Oh, God, this is getting really dark. Oh, man.
You can cut that if you want.
Yeah. No, I don't care. My brother actually probably listens to this more than anything.
I thought that was going a different direction. My brother is actually a serial rapist.
Oh, dear.
So it's okay.
Oh, dear.
All right,
poor
parents. Should we start tying the knot?
Yeah, he was laughing at, like, the love cast. He was laughing at all my love miseries. It was traumatic, man. Anyways, continue.
I don't know. Should we start tying up some knots here?
Some loose ends.
I thought we skipped a few questions, did we?
You can throw them at me.
Okay. Who's your favorite Pokemon?
Fucking Onix.
Thank you, everybody, for joining the podcast. This has been
I don't even
Gage.
Know why I said that. It's not Onix. It's the first one that came into my head that wasn't Pikachu.
Yeah.
Niall, I want you to take this seriously. If you're not taking this seriously, then ooh. I don't even know why.
I do like Gengar, though.
Gengar is great. Good. I like Gengar, Gyarados, Charizard. Those are the really cool ones.
Charizard's just a fucking midget dragon. Like, if you look at him, he's like not that much taller than Ash.
My three favorites are, I really like Raichu. I like Arcanine a lot. I love
Arcanine.
Yeah, he's cool. Arcanine's cool, man.
And then,
Pinsir's also really
for
cool.
For some reason, I have such a soft spot for Wailord. It's like the biggest
is
fucking...
Is it because you're a Gaylord?
Yeah! He just, you know, reminds me of my Freudian subtle things that I love, you know?
That's true. I don't know. I'm an adult. I don't watch Pokemon. Sorry, autists out there who watch Pokemon.
I just realized that I spent 100 hours in the new Pokemon game. So.
I realized that I like binge watched all of season one on Netflix like a few days ago.
I don't even go that far. Watch history.
I don't watch Pokemon. I just play the games.
The games are cool, though. Is the new game good?
The new game is really good because it changes up the formula just a little bit. There's no gym leaders anymore.
Really?
Well, now you have to fight, like, giant Pokemon instead of, like, gym leaders.
Bullshit.
And they're, like, super tough. This is real.
Call this bullshit.
Real 2017.
Call them bullshit.
Okay. Yeah. You can research after the podcast.
I will.
And find out. Yeah, Pokemon Sun, just type in gym leaders. Or totem Pokemon, and you'll see that I'm telling the truth.
They're called something weird. They're not called Pokemon anymore. They're called like
Digimon.
Yeah. Yeah. No,
the big Pokemon are called totem Pokemon.
Are they? I could have sworn they had a different name. But anyways, this is completely irrelevant to the podcast.
Yeah, no, I just made up the Pokemon question. I apologize to all of our serious NPR listeners. I'm sorry, Mark Maron. I'm sorry, Joe Rogan.
I'm sure someone out there was interested.
Joe Rogan. No, that's a podcast. No, that's one that you guys should interview. You learn all about the magic mushrooms. You learn all about the third eye. You learn all about the 9-to-5 jobs that you shouldn't do.
The magic
eye. Podcast.
What do you mean by that? What do you mean that we should listen to and we should get the 9-to-5 job? Are you saying that it sort of reflects sort of the American dream?
No. That's it's just like a thing he does. Like it's like I listen to that podcast and every fucking episode he's like, it's so bizarre that people work 9-to-5 jobs like every week. And they're just miserable. And like, meanwhile, he's like billionaire just from being like fucking a stand-up comedian.
Yeah, for being the Fear Factor host.
And the Fear Factor host. He just got so lucky. Though he probably did work really hard too. But a lot of stars did align in his favor. It's just funny to me when people do that stuff.
That's actually something I would like to know. What's your sort of podcast inspirations?
Ricky Gervais podcast, hands down. That's like my main one. Have you ever listened to it? It's probably old at this day. Yeah, it came out like 10 years ago. Shit. But it's one of the first popular podcasts. It was fucking gold. It was brilliant.
I saw the Ricky Gervais show, which I think they
just
had like...
That's based off the podcast.
Like,
that's
based off the podcast,
yeah,
and they used clips from that. And I didn't think the clips were that funny they used, yeah.
And also, there's like a bit of a translation like between like the islands, like England and America. Like, there's a humor that's probably not going to be as understood over here as it is over there. I'm not saying like English people have better humor. It's just like a lot of references to like British TV and British humor and British culture. So
right.
A lot of people would kind of be lost in translation.
I got
but it's really
you.
Funny. It's a really funny podcast. I love it.
Go check out the Ricky Gervais podcast. Available 2007.
But like I went as far back as to listen to his old radio show that he used to do before the podcast. There's like an archive of like hundreds of those online, which is like better if not.
Wait, what is it called?
It's called just the Ricky Gervais Show. It's XFM.
Oh, okay. I thought you...
You can like torrent it. It's like the XFM, and it's not illegal because his old radio shows to torrent it, so I can actually plug a torrent, but you can torrent like the XFM Ricky Gervais archive. There's like a shit ton there. It's really good.
I was actually thinking that it was like a radio drama that you're referring to.
No, it's a podcast just like this one. It's
a podcast a lot like this. No, I'm trying to be like on a dark and stormy night a lot like this one tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to do that, but with podcasts. It's not working out. Anyways, continue.
You just failed miserably. Yeah, so it would be that
one. That's fine. That's fine. It happens.
I do listen to Joe Rogan even though I make fun of him, but like I just can't help it. I like to watch it when I play in like Skyrim or something. I just like sit down and just put on a podcast and like play a game or something.
Are you excited for the Nintendo Switch Skyrim?
I was never the biggest thing. I was never a huge Nintendo guy, so like a lot of my friends are gamers and they always fucking talk about Nintendo games and shit like Monster Hunter. I don't know. I was never a big Nintendo guy. I like my first game console was a PlayStation and I kind of stuck to the PlayStation, so I never got into it. So I wasn't really that excited. Not really. I don't care. But I do think it's amazing that you can play Skyrim sitting on the shitter like now.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty cool.
That's what 90% of people are going to do with it.
Yeah, that is quite amazing, I have to say.
Well, I think we are wrapping up at this point.
Wait, why the fuck are people freaking out over Mario being in New York City? Did you see that new trailer?
I think they're probably freaking out because it looks a lot like Sonic 06.
I saw that trailer, and the city looked nice. It
was
really stylized, and it looked cool. And it kind of played like Mario. Like, it looked like it played like Mario Super Mario 64. The gameplay looked like that.
That's what I think the appeal was.
I thought that it was in a nice setting. Like, I know it's a city and it's different from Mario, but why not change up the fucking setting instead of having a goddamn Goomba
See,
wrench?
I would argue against that and say they didn't change it up enough. It's just like a rehash of Super Mario 64. It's a rehash of Super Mario Sunshine.
Oh, I disagree, but...
But they're also trying new things, like with the city and stuff, and like, I don't know, it's like, make up your mind, dude.
I didn't understand the theme until like 2 minutes into the trailer, so at first when he was just running around the city and doing that kind of thing, I was like, what is going on here? I thought the whole game was based around that city, and then I realized it was...
No, yeah, because it's changed levels. It changed to more traditional-looking Mario levels.
He's
like,
traveling,
right?
He's traveling from different, maybe, like, dimensions or from different areas
so
of the world.
Yeah, so that was just, like,
I
one area.
Idea.
Like,
yeah.
I don't understand what the fucking big... I probably
are you
going
saying
to
freaking out in, like, a good way or a bad way?
Well, I just saw Twitter, and they're all, like, making fun of it, which is funny, because some of them were actually funny. Like, they'd have GTA and, like, Mario, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the fact that it was just, like, one little level that I thought looked kind of nice as far as, like, a handheld console level goes, and it played, like, Mario 64. Which is a really fun game. And like, people are freaking out over Mario and Unreal Engine. That fucking... Did you ever see that video?
I did,
Someone remade Mario 64 and Unreal Engine, and like, people are freaking out over the new graphics, and like, they're like, oh, they should make this. And then they finally like, make something
like
similar, and people are fucking complaining, but...
No, people will never be satisfied.
I don't really
people
care enough about Mario.
Speaking of never being satisfied, I think this podcast is over.
Oh, okay.
All right, so let's start hitting some final thoughts.
I'm sorry. Did you have any more questions for Niall?
I didn't have any more questions for Niall. He hit all the bases that I wanted.
Yeah, I was just looking through the questions and I'm like, I think we hit all of them.
Sorry for not being like that funny in this podcast. I like woke
no,
up and then
no.
did this.
We don't bring you on and expect you to be funny. We bring you on because we're not. We expect your personality, which I think we got.
That's very nice. I just kind of wanted to bring Borth here. So
a different
cool.
side of Niall. This should be called the normal side of Niall. Normal Niall.
Yep.
Because we talked normal about normality.
Niall. It's like the worst nickname ever. Normal now.
That just harkens back to those days of like him just trying to conform to normalcy.
Yeah.
It's boring.
Yeah.
Normal Niall.
Normal Niall.
Oh, yeah.
Do we still want to do final thoughts for this episode?
Sure. I like it.
Okay. Final thoughts, Niall. Niall, what are some of your final thoughts on what we have discussed here today?
Like my actual final thoughts on my deathbed?
No, I mean, if you...
Sure, yeah. What's your final thoughts on your deathbed?
I don't know. It hasn't happened yet.
Regarding the things that we talked about on the podcast in terms of being normal yourself, being bullied, something like that, you know, what would you say to audience members and just be like,
I would say that I'm a complete hypocrite because I fucking bullied this kid so badly when I was like younger than that, so I probably did deserve it. It was probably fucking karma's way of kicking me in the ass, which I did learn a lot from, and I don't think bullying should be, it shouldn't be like banned. Like I feel like I learned a lot from it, and I learned how to not be like, I don't know, you shouldn't be an asshole. Just don't be an asshole, but also Learn to be able to take a joke, but when it goes too far,
stand up for yourself.
Smack him in the jaw, whoever's doing it. Just
oh god,
show him who's boss. No, but stand up for yourself, basically. You know, it's not the end of the world if you're being bullied. Don't like kill yourself or anything. Just have a good time. Figure out why they're bullying you. Realize that they're really trying to make other people laugh at your expense, and then plot a way to like kill them.
Don't kill yourself.
Perfect.
Kill them.
That's my
perfect.
2 cents.
Don't kill yourself, kill them. Niall Murray, 2017.
I was gonna said that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Jean-Claude Guidi, 2017.
I don't want him going to jail because of something I said.
Well, that was our plan. We were going to frame Niall and then send him to jail. Invite him on our podcast, frame him, send him to jail, and then feed off of his bitches.
Oh. Oh.
Okay.
Oh. I wasn't informed about that. That was
Jean-Claude, what are your final thoughts?
Final thoughts to platform off of Niall's thing. Yeah, stand up for yourself. It's not essential that you make friends with everybody, and that's a useful lesson to learn, that you don't have to be friends with everyone. And sometimes you need to cut people out of their life if they're being an asshole, because eventually they're going to wake up one day and realize no one likes them, and everyone's just brown-nosing them because they have money. What
there
else? And they have money because they draw a shitload of hentai and they have a Ferrari. So thank you. That's my final thought.
Celebrity.
So, oh, sorry. Oh, my bad. Yeah.
My final thoughts are stray away from whatever is normal, whatever you think is cool, because in about 6 months, people aren't going to think that's cool anymore. Don't Harlem shake. Don't dab. Don't whip and nay nay. Just please, please, please impress yourself.
Do Gangnam Style.
Do Gangnam Style.
That's the
anything.
Original meme, and we want it to stay that way forever.
Okay, that's your advice.
No. Hold on. All you need to do, I know it's cliche, I know it's been said many times, but impress yourself, impress who you were yesterday. Just better yourself every single day, little by little, and one day you'll be an immortal being and have your dad be Jesus.
Smoke weed every day, guys. Smoke weed.
Smoke every weed day. Every day. Take it from Snoop Dogg himself.
Every day.
Don't forget, guys. Smoke weed every day. I'm Niall, and this has been the Almost Adults Podcast, signing out.